Okay.
So the edge position is bright field means there's no rings in the way, so it's just straight light coming through, right? And then you got phase 0, pH 0, phase 1, pH 1, phase 2, pH 2. And then DIC position is an empty position, back to bright field, also empty. So you got three empty positions and three phase positions. This is important to know because you have objectives that can do phase contrast. All right? So your objectives are, you got a 10x, 20x, 40x. You got three objectives, right, to start.
Oh, it changes.
Yeah, it does. Isn't it nice?
Yeah.
Oh, it looks like you got all long distance objectives. So I can actually use the 1 millimeter because they're actually designed to work with look through 1 millimeter thick, even glass or plastic. So
you don't have to turn it upside down.
If you turn it upside down, then you have to adjust the correction collar to get the best focus. I'll take one of the objectives out and show you guys how to do that. But the important thing to remember right now is the 10x uses the phase one. All right, so you got to turn the ring to phase one if you want to do phase. The 20x uses the phase two, so you got to turn this to phase two when you're doing 20x. And the 40x also uses the phase two, so you gotta turn to phase two. All right, good. So if I take one of the objectives out,
or you can take them out.
Yeah, you can always take objectives out, but don't do it, okay? What I'll do is, since most of your work will be based on dishes or plates, they're on average 1 millimeter thick, right? So we will want to have the correction collar ring set to one.
Okay.
So you can see it goes from 0 to 1.5, right? So you want to set it at one. So the little dot here is 0.17, means if you want to do cover slip, you can always go there, and now it's cover slip corrected. But since most of your work will be on dishes or plates, we should just set it on one. And if you want to do slide, then you just have to slide face that where the cover slip is facing upwards. Okay. Right, if you want to do it this way, then you have to turn the ring to the dot.
Okay.
But
there's no need to.
There shouldn't be a need to if you're just doing 10, 20, and 40 with dishes and slides like that. So you can just leave it at one for all of them. All right. But just know that if you ever have trouble focusing, you want to check to see if this guy has been accidentally turned to 1.5 or anything less. So that messes up its focusing. All right. You can do that without having to remove the objective. You kind of have to peek your head in, look from the side.
Yeah.
And you're going to see that, okay, the line's at one or not. Okay?
Okay.
All right. So. No. Okay. So, once again, if you're going to 10x, I know I'm going to 10x, so I don't want to look at things in phase, I want to turn to the phase ring. And now, to do phase contrast, I will have to turn on the TL illumination. Okay, and now I can look through the eyepiece. If I don't see anything through the eyepiece, this probably means that the light may not be sending, that the micro is not sending light through the eyepiece, it could be sending light to the camera. So I can now go to the light path and see if it's going to the eyes or not. Right now it is.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to go to the camera, you can always hit this camera thing and it goes to the camera. Then you want to go back to the eyes, you hit the eyes, and it's going to go back to the eyes.
Okay.
Okay.
So you're doing bright field right now?
Yeah.
Or should you be on H?
No, I'm doing phase right now.
Okay.
Yeah, sorry. Right. So if you see like green coming through, that means there's a filter in a way, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so what you do is now you go to the reflector
You have six positions in a filter turret. There's three, I take it back, you only have three filters right now. DAP, GIP, and a DS red. So you can add another one if you want to, a far red in the future. But right now you got a three basic visible wavelengths, green, red, and blue, okay? Mm-hmm. So by any other position, those are empty positions, so if you hit any of them, it's gonna now move to position where there's basically just light, normal light, right? Okay? One other thing, little thing, but sometimes it can cause problems, is this binoc tube has a shutter.
Okay.
If this is in this position, it actually shutters the light, the binoc tube here, so there's no ambient light coming through.
Yeah.
Right? So, but it, which also means you can't see anything or darkness, right? Yeah. So this needs to be in the up position at all times.
Open eye.
Okay? All right? Little steps that, you know, if you can't see anything, you do the right light path or anything, then check here and make sure that this is open. Once it's open, then you need to focus on your sample. As you can see, you can move the stage as you as you're focusing. As on this F1 button here, you press it once, it goes slow. Press it again, it goes fast.
Mm-hmm.
Press it again, it goes slow. Okay.
So we have the speed here as well. Are they the same?
No, they're technically not the same. So yeah, he hit a button the other day that drops the stage. So you don't want to try not to mess with this. If you do mess with it, I don't know which one you press. Maybe one of these guys. This one? Yeah, the first one.
Yeah, so, I was one of those.
Yeah. So if you ever hit this by mistake, do not hit set work position. Do not hit any other button. Just hit that to cancel it. Okay. All right.
Okay.
This is this one here. Arrow the. Let's cancel that. All right?
Okay.
Andrew?
So stay away from this.
Yeah. Okay. So we can focus with this thing or this knob over here. It's
correct.
Thing.
Yeah.
Right.
So coarse focus, fine focus, coarse focus, fine focus. Same thing. Right?
Yeah.
So the beauty of this is you kind of have no choice. This can be attached to the side of the microscope here.
Mm-hmm.
But because of the incubation chamber, it won't fit. So you have no choice but to put it here on the table, right? In this case, right? But having this gives you the option of now working off of the screen. You can now focus here without having to go to the microscope, which is kind of nice.
Yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
Right, so anyways, I'm seeing some cells, right? Phase one.
Yeah.
And then I can increase or decrease the phase or bright field intensity here. All right, so brighter, less bright, brighter, less bright. Yeah, okay. If you guys want, may not be a bad idea to put a little sticky here and say this is, bright field or phase intensity. All right, I've seen people do that, it helps, you know. And then put a little sticky here, IP shutter needs to be open. Alright. When you want to do fluorescence, right? So now what you do is you turn off the TL illumination, shut that guy off, right? You turn the RL illumination on, right? Which will now turn on the shutter for the reflected path. And now if you move to any cube, say you want to do GFP, right? Then turn it on again. I'm sorry, you have to move it, you have to turn it on.
Close the shutter.
Yeah. Yeah, so if this shutter is open, you should see light coming through, right? Right. And if it's the right dyes, you should see green coming back at you. Now, when you work with fluorescence, obviously you need to have your room light turned off. Otherwise, you're introducing noise where it shouldn't be, right?
Doesn't it also bleach? Samples, why aren't yours bleached?
Oh, because mine's fixed and it has anti-fade agents on it.
All right.
So it's designed to last forever.
Okay.
So that's why. Live cells will bleach, so
yeah.
Try to minimize exposing as much as you can. So once you find it in focus, make sure you shut it off. Make it a habit.
All
right?
Is it better to turn it off there or just close the shutter?
It's the same thing.
Okay.
It's not the same thing, I take it back. No, turn it off here.
Okay.
All right? Because that is not software control. This is.
Okay.
Right? The software will automatically do it for you once you're in the imaging mode. Make sense?
Yep.
Okay. All right. So whole point of me showing you that is just to say, look, before you even start imaging, you got to kind of find where you need to be in your sample, right? And this is how you do it. You use the touchscreen, and then you find where you need to be, and then go from there, right? So you can always check the different samples to see if everything's lighting up where it should be. All right, so that's pretty good. So you've got three colors on that one, so I can turn it off again so it doesn't bleach, all right? Questions?
Not so far.
Okay, good. This red tape here means don't touch. But I'm going to take it off and show you guys in a minute why it could be helpful sometimes. But most cases, you don't have to worry about it. All right, so software. So you go to ZEN, double click on it, turns on the software. And then you have an option whether it's just image processing, meaning it's not going to control the microscope, or you can go ZEN Pro, which means it's going to control the microscope. It's kind of redundant, so I can actually tell it not to turn that on if you want.
No, it doesn't matter. Yeah, we know.
You guys know that, right? Yeah. Okay, so you can go ZEN Pro. All right, so it takes a while for it to initialize hardware. Again, if you did the correct steps turning everything on, it should be able to see everything that's on.
Okay, I turn on the light. Doesn't matter.
Hmm?
Should I turn on the light?
No, why? That's okay. Okay, good. No error messages means everything's fine. The only time you see error messages if something's not seen or something's broken. Okay? That's when you call me. All right. So, in the locate tab, in the light path, so locate tab basically is like what we were doing here. Right? Mm-hmm. With the slight exception that I can also program certain buttons to do what you were doing here by pressing the touchscreen. For example, if you have a GFP sample, then if you hit this button, it turns on GFP for you. And then you can toggle to the DS Red if you wanted to, or to DAPI. Or you can also go to TL, which means phase, right? If you have the phase ring on. Make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Then this all off button just says shut everything off. Okay. Make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now again, this is in the locate tab, so it's really used for just locating a sample. So say you didn't want to work through your microscope, or you're sick of seeing things through your eyepiece, you can also do this. Turn on the live, and then turn on GFP, and then so long as you have the exposure time set correctly, you can also do an auto exposure, right? Oh, not seeing anything. Why is that? Oh, it's through the eyes.
Oh, you have to send it to the camera, right?
It should have gone automatically. But there you go.
The eyes.
Why is that?
Now we call you.
No. I see it. I don't know why. It's a settings issue. It's easy to fix. My bad. Okay. I
I should do it all off. This X, something else. Closed. Closed. Okay, perfect. Good. All right, good. Go back to live. Go on GFP. There you go. Should work now. So you can also kind of help define your sample this way, or we can use this guy to focus as well. Okay, and now we can toggle between the different dyes. As long as you have that set for auto exposure, it's going to auto expose for you. There you go. That beat. God bless you.
Thank you.
There you go. Okay. All right. So the whole point of locate is just to help you find your sample, and then just make sure to remember to turn it all off when you're done finding it. Now you can go to acquisition. This is where the magic happens. So the acquisition tab will allow you to do, program what you want the microscope to do for you. Make sense?
Yeah.
Right now, for today, we're going to learn how to do a three-color imaging on fluorescent sample. All right, because that's the basic, right? If you know how to do that, then everything else is just a matter of checking a checkbox to activate other functionalities. Make sense? We may want to touch a little bit on time series since you guys are trying to do some live cell. If we have time, we can try to do that. But today, at least when I leave here, all of you should be able to do a three-color imaging. And then once you get the bubbler all set up and all that, and you have samples, call me back in and we can work on the time series and all that as well. Okay?
Okay.
Yeah. All right. All right. So in acquisition, right, so there is a default all channels, which means if you go to the channel tab, there's already set up for you by default all these different dyes. Did you set this up, Andrew?
Yeah.
S1?
S1 and I did.
Oh, you did, yeah? Did you override it?
No. I just added somewhere.
How did you add it? I made it read-only, didn't I?
This was before you came and made it read-only.
Oh, okay. Alright. Alright, well, we'll decide on that later. So say you have somebody new coming in and doesn't know how to use the software at all, right? They go to acquisition, right? So we have something called a smart setup.
Okay.
So if you hit smart setup, right, what it does is it allows a user to plug in, you hit the plus button, the dyes that you're using for fluorescence. So what do you have? You have what? Say ethyl dimethyl benzoate for, is that what you have? 330? Or maybe in this case, I know what I have, so I have a DAPI, right? Oops. All right. So I can say, okay, I have DAPI, so I'm going to double click that. So it's going to say, all right, first channel, DAPI, and then I also have GFP. Right? And I say, I also have GFP. And then I'll say, okay, I also have, I don't know, RFP maybe, right? And so here you go. It has the three channels. It didn't come up with any error messages, meaning that the dyes that you're using has the corresponding filters to accommodate those dyes.
Okay.
Make sense?
Yeah.
And as I mentioned, this is a monochrome camera. What you acquire is going to be black and white, but you can assign a color to it. Here's your chance to assign a color to it. Right.
Okay.
So by default,
it's
assigned It's default by the smart setup. But if you don't like this lighter shade of blue, you can always change it to a darker shade of blue if you like.
Okay.
All right. Now remember, you can also do this post acquisition. Right. You can still change the color or the pseudo color or the applied color to it after you acquire it as well. All right. So you can always change your mind later on. But I like it in a darker blue, so I'm going to pick that one. If you hit OK. It's now going to set everything up for you in the channels to do those three colors.
Nice.
Okay. Meaning, for somebody who doesn't know any microscopy at all, right, then all they have to do is set this at auto exposure, right?
And if they had done the locate tab, at least if they had at least done the locate tab, right? Mm-hmm. And they know they're sort of in focus, then all you have to do is snap, and it's just gonna do the three colors.
Okay.
Done.
Well, that was easy.
All right.
And that dark blue is because you changed the color.
Yeah. So here's what I said. If you change your mind, right? You can go, all right, I don't like that dark blue. Mike doesn't know what he's talking about. I like a turquoise.
Okay.
All right. Cool. Or blue, or you can open up custom, and you have a whole palette to choose from. All right. Okay. How easy is that?
Pretty easy.
Pretty easy. So for somebody who doesn't know anything, you can use a smart setup. You're lazy.
The in terms of the settings here, you just have to set this to auto exposure.
So again, auto exposure is for people who just don't care about what exposure time is. They're not doing any quantitative studies.
Mm-hmm.
All right, meaning you don't have to set an exposure time.
Okay.
All right. Mm-hmm. So then you can do auto, because that is going to change based on the intensity of the dyes based on different samples. Okay, but it's going to automatically select an exposure time for you, so you don't have to worry about that. Okay?
Yep.
All right? If you're doing quantitative studies, then you should not have auto exposure. You should actually manually set the exposure. You have to type in exposure time, for example.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so for each individual channel. Right? Say I want this one at also at 50, right? Guy, I'd say also 50. Well, they're all the same exposure time, for real. Interesting. Or maybe you just don't know. So now if you set it all, then it's gonna see how it disengages auto exposure.
Yeah.
Right. So now when you snap, it's gonna use that exposure time to snap it. Boom. Okay.
Nice.
So it will look different from here because that has a different exposure time setting than this one. But the data, and then you can always sort of change the way the data appears, not changing the data, because the histogram doesn't change. This is what you've acquired. But you can change the way it looks by doing this. So some people call it photoshopping, but in reality it's not. You can also do it based on each individual channel. All you're doing is you can clean up the background by not showing it, right?
Yeah.
You see that? This part here is background. Once you bring it closer to the blue band, then you're only showing the blue channel, so you have less background. Do the same for, that was the green. So you can do the same for the blue, and you do the same for the red. Or you can do all. But all will be just all channels.
Yeah.
You want to individually do that. So again, all of a sudden your signal to noise looks better, it looks cleaner and all that. So, but you're not changing data again, right? So your histogram didn't change, you just changed how you're displaying it. You can reset that back to normal on all channels and you can see that's the original image, so.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Okay.
If you're gonna do the quantitative way, which I presume that this is gonna be something you guys will be doing a lot of, you can go to the live image, right? Right, and now you can say, okay, am I happy with 50, or should I set the parameters a little differently? You know, for this sample, I've always done it at 80, for example. You know, I can set that for 80 and then see how it looks, you know. So that's probably your positive control, right? So when you take your negatives at 80 milliseconds, it should come through as no color, correct? Nothing, no signal. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. So. And you can always do that by not selecting auto exposure, okay? Everything else, you don't have to worry about it for now. They're all pretty much factory default, so it should get you a pretty decent image already. I wouldn't worry about that. We can save that for additional functionalities moving forward. Secondly, once you've acquired those images, right, you can split them up into different channels if you want to look at it that way.
How'd you do that? You get split,
yeah. You can do a gallery. Right. There's no galleries because you're not doing anything else other than just channels right now, right? But the important thing is you want to know how to save this image, right? So rule number one, I would recommend that you always save this as the .czi file first, because it contains everything, right? Your metadata, your original data, everything, and it saves that one file, right? So it makes your life easier, right? So let's call this one training, right? So once you save that, right, now you can have fun with it. So if you go now, go to the processing tab, right? You can go to the different methods, right? So now say, hey, you know, my software can only open JPEGs or TIFFs, or publications requires a TIFF file. Are you guys familiar with all the different file formats? Mm-hmm. Yes, okay. So now you can do, say, I can do an image export, right? So now you can say, okay, hey, you know, I have all these different types of formats I can export it to. You want to have the show all button checked here because you have more functions or more settings you can set. If you don't have that, it's a very basic, high quality, low quality, so you won't have that turned on. And say you want to save it as a JPEG, if you did any kind of modification here, like, you know, making the picture look pretty, you know, you spend all your time trying to make it look good or not, you know, show it the way you want to show it, then if you want that to be exported as the JPEG as well, meaning anything that you change to the image in terms of how it looks, you want to make sure that you check this box here, apply display curve and channel color. Make sense?
Yeah.
All right. If you had put in any kind of graphics, for example, you can throw a skill bar on there. So if you go to graphics.
There's a problem in the skill bar.
Why?
I cannot save the skill bar in other. I can save it in.
CZI,
but not other images.
For real? Because you didn't set burn-in graphics.
Mm-hmm.
So this has to be checked.
Okay.
Where'd you add the scale bar?
This little ruler here, on the graphics little ruler. Yeah. So if you don't like, I did another one, sorry. If you don't like the way it looks, meaning it's red fonts, and so tiny, and the lines have the borders around it, if you right click, you can always say format graphical elements, and then you can change the line color if you want to, change the font size, text size,
the fonts,
yeah, exactly. All right, so if you check burning graphics, this is checked, then that skill bar should be exported with the image, right? Now you also have the choice, do you want to just export it as a merged image, or do you want to export it with the three individual images as well? My guess is you want to export it with the three individual images as well, right? So then you got to make sure that you also select the individual channels image.
So finally, we have four images.
We have four images in total, right?
Individual channels.
Yeah. So then, ZEN allows you to also say, hey, do you want to create a folder, right? So because you're exporting four images, right, it would be nice if everything is dumped into a folder.
Yep.
Fair enough? So yeah, you probably want to say, hey, create folder, and then you can select the destination where you want to send it to. I'm going to send it to the desktop for now, okay? And then you can have a prefix of the folder name, right? All right, so I'm going to call it training for this purpose, right? So now if you hit apply, if you had everything all set up correctly, if you hit apply, I should expect to see four images in total, the three individual plus the merge, plus each image will have a scale bar assigned to it. And it will show,
training.
It probably will be named training for each file, and then it will apply your display curves and everything. So let's see. In a training folder, where are you? So 1, 2, 3, 4 images, all called training. C1, C2, 1, 2, 3, C2, C3 means channel 1, channel 2, channel 3. I don't remember how you can name the. Oh, here you go. You can also use channel names.
Mm-hmm.
So meaning, if you now apply it again, training. Here you go. So now you have training. DAPI training. GFP. MRP. All right. And the training merge is the same. So. Anyways, all right, and if I open any of the images, the skill bar should be there as well. Okay, let's just make sure it did do it for everything. Right there, see? And that's it, my friends.
cool.
Pretty straightforward, right?
Yeah.
All right.
Definitely a lot of important stuff in the processing tab I did not know about.
You did not know that. Yeah.
So I had no idea you could add.
So I can even make this as a default if you want. Or can I do that?
Yeah, that's great.
Yeah, if you could, yeah, that'd be.
I don't think I can.
All right. Well, we have a video of it.
Spoke too soon. Sorry, guys.
Hopefully, that's all right. I will have the storage space.
Yeah, this video is gold.
You know what you can do? You can save this.
Yep.
Yeah. Can we call it something like this?
Let's call it. There you go. New. Yeah. Let's call it JPEG.
Yeah, that's fine.
Then we want to make sure that those are all checked. Okay. And save. Cool. So you can always drop and pick that, and then that should come off. So we can go back to this. All right. So if I change anything, for example, right? Say I want to go. Say I'll go here.
You can do video microscoping.
Yeah, the continuous.
JPEG. Ta-da!
Yes.
Okay, nice. All right.
So can you please go to the continuous?
Which continuous? Videos. All right. So we're gonna do a time series real quick. Okay. At least that's something that you might want to get started pretty soon. So, time series basically, once you check that, right? And it only exists in the acquisition tab, right? So then your time series tab comes in, right? Really, time series is as simple as this. How many time points and how long you want to do the experiment for?
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
For example, you want to monitor cell activity over a period of 1 hour, but you don't know how fast it's going to move, so you're going to assume or guesstimate that it's going to, if you take a picture every 5 minutes, it should cover that movement without losing any temporal resolution, meaning you don't lose any activity in between. Right?
Right.
Make sense? So, okay, let's try that. So I'm going to do the durations is how long I'm going to do it for. And I can choose 1 hour. And I'd say the intervals, I want to do every 5 minutes. And then it'll be like, well, what do I want to acquire on this cell, right? So for example, you want to do all three colors, right? So you want to make sure that these three colors are checked, right?
Yeah.
All right. And you can always recheck the cells, how they're looking by clicking through each channel, making sure they're okay. Now here's the difference between checking it and clicking on a channel, right? Checking it means that when you hit snap, it's going to acquire those images, those channels. Clicking between them allows you to toggle between the different channels. You see the difference?
Mm-hmm.
All right, good. All right. So if you stop that, so if you say you've set all your parameters correctly, right? So now you go back to time series. We're not gonna wait 1 hour to do this. So let's try to do this in 1 minute, okay? And I'll say just to have some fun. Let's do this every 10 seconds. So there should be 6 images total, correct? There?
Yep.
Okay. You also have the choice of doing as long as possible and use camera streaming if possible. So as long as possible is pretty self-explanatory, right?
No.
It's going to keep going until you tell it to stop.
Possible.
Oh, okay.
Until you tell it
to stop. Or until your hard disk space is used up.
Okay.
So be careful when you check that.
Yeah.
And use camera streaming if possible. It means it is actually going to increase the speed of the camera, of the acquisition. But then you lose control of the intervals. Meaning it's going to keep acquiring until the duration is met. Make sense?
Okay.
Not really.
Instead of setting the time. Right,
instead of saying every 10 seconds, it's going to take a picture as fast as it can until the 1 minute is up. Make sense?
Okay,
good. So be careful of using that as well. All right. So if you set these parameters correctly and you have the channels all set up, now if you hit snap, actually, wrong. Once you have any of these checked, you now have to hit start experiment because it becomes an experiment. When you have more than one function set up, it has to be experiment. When you're only doing the channels, it's a snap. Make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, so now you hit start experiment. So what it's gonna do is gonna take a three color image first, then it's gonna wait 10 seconds, hopefully, right? Mm-hmm. So next one in 2, 1, 0. It's gonna take another three image, or three colors on the same image, and it's gonna wait again. Right?
Yeah.
So now if you go to the split view, you're going to see the same three channel colors and then merge. If, now if you go gallery, now you'll be able to see the different time points. All right?
Okay.
You can now add other stuff like relative time here, and then you can see that the time will change for each image. You can't really see it here, but trust me, it does.
So right now it's experiment.czi file. How do I save the individual?
So before we get there, right? So now because you've taken a time series, you notice that this time scale comes up, right? So you can now you can play it back. It's a dead sample, so it's kind of boring. but if you have living cells, you should start seeing things moving around in this quote unquote movie, all right? But it's really just playing back the individual time points that you're taking, mm-hmm. all right? Now, if you want to, now you want to export it as a movie, then you go to movie export, right? Now your parameters now are different, right? So now you have different formats you can export it to, depending on what you're using. This is a hit and miss. So I can't tell you which one's the right one, so you have to try it out and see which one works best for what you guys, what movies you guys are generating. Okay? This is all different based on what computer you're using, what compression ratios you're using, and factors and all that. So. But play around with this till you find the right sort of setting for it, then you can always save it. All right?
Sure.
Yeah.
And that's time series, my friend. Easy or what?
Very cool.
That's all you do. Okay? Okay. We'll touch on the other aspects of it once you guys have real samples to work with and once you have a real humidifier system to work with.
So can we go through the 2.5D, like 3D?
You got nothing here because you haven't done a Z-step yet. Oh, okay. So yeah, so this is... it doesn't tell you anything right now. It's probably just based on time, relative to time, I guess, right? No Z. Yeah, not much going on right now. Once you learn how to do Z-stack, then you can use the 3D function. It's better. You can render it, okay? All right, guys, I got to head to my next appointment, unfortunately.
Hey, thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
All right.
Very helpful.
You want to say something to close the video?
Be careful. Don't break anything. Call me if you have any questions. And let me know when you're ready with the humidifying.
Okay.